Welcome, everyone. I'm glad you're here. If you're watching online, we welcome you as well. Just thanks for being here. It's fun to see more people every week in here. So if you are online watching, make sure to share the service. We want everyone to hear the good news of Jesus. And connection cards, you'll see them around on the chairs. Fill them out, and online there's a link that you can do the connection cards as well. And as we continue our service, I'd like to read from Psalm 71, 14 through 18. But I will hope continually and will praise you yet more and more. My mouth will tell you of your righteous acts, of your deeds of salvation all the day, for their number is past my knowledge. With the mighty deeds of the Lord God, I will come. I will remind them of your righteousness, yours alone. O God, from my youth you have taught me, and I still proclaim your wondrous deeds. So even to old age and gray hairs, O God, do not forsake me until I proclaim your might to another generation, your power to all those who come.
Stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even Good morning. We want to spend some time in prayer now. And, you know, I think hopefully we can look back over our week and we can see how God has been working in our lives. He's been working in our midst. He's been a way maker. He's been a miracle worker. Maybe this past week we can see his hand because he's constantly at work in each and every one of our lives. Hopefully we can see that. Maybe we can even look back a little bit further in our lives and we can see how his hand has been upon us. And so we just want to spend some time this morning just praising him. You can praise him in your hearts. You can praise him out loud. If you're online, you can type your praise in the comments, however you want to do that. Let's just spend that time right now recognizing that God is at work and he's in our midst, and let's praise him for it. There are times in our lives where we can't see him working. We don't feel that he's working. And so in those moments, we need to cry out to him as well. Don't let those times drag you away from him. He's always there and he's always at work. So in those moments, maybe you can look back this past week and you can say, in this area of my life, I haven't seen him working. I'm not sure he's working. I question it, and I need help. Lift those moments up to him as well. Where is your need? Tell him that right now. God, we praise you this morning for all that you've done. We praise you for who you are. You are a great and an awesome God. You're a way maker. You're a miracle worker. You're so much. We can't even communicate all that you are because you're so big. But we do our best this morning to lift our praise to you and to worship you, not only in our singing, but as we open your word and open your scriptures and we learn how we can live lives that glorify you each and every day. And I pray that you will continually be at work in our midst and that we'll recognize it more and more and more, and we will be able to point the way to you, and we'll give you glory. Amen.
You are here.
Amen. Amen. Well, we are continuing in our series. We're actually concluding our series today called Legacy. We're on Legacy Principle number 5. And this time has really flown by. We're already in week number 5, and I can't believe it. And maybe you've been a part of this series, and or maybe this is your first week, and you're like, I'm here at the tail end of this series. Well, don't worry. If you want, you can go back and you can check it out from our website, and you can get caught up. But today we conclude it with legacy principle number 5, and what we've been learning is that. We've been learning from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. We've been learning how we can leave a legacy of faith to the generations coming behind us and how important that is. We've been learning that Moses spoke these words in Deuteronomy chapter 6. He spoke these words to the nation of Israel when they were on the brink of entering into the promised land. Their dream was about to come true. They were going to have a land of their own. And as they are entering into the promised land, Moses stands in front of the people and he gives this sermon, this speech. He says these very, very famous words and very important words. He says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them upon your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates." And so will you read these words with me? And I've been encouraging you to memorize them, even just to memorize the first couple verses. And maybe you've been working on it, maybe you haven't. But if you're here in the room, read with me. If you're online, you should be able to see the words as well. Let's read these verses together. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates." And so let me just review a little bit as we wrap up the series. We learned way back in week number 1 that it all starts with a firm foundation. That foundation is the Lord our God, the Lord who is one. And that was Israel's foundation. That was what Israel's foundation, that was who Israel's foundation was, the Lord our God, the Lord who was one. One God, and not only one God, but the one and only God. And if he is your foundation, if he is your one and only, then it's important that you focus your priorities on what matters most. That was legacy principle number 1. Week number 2, we saw the importance of relationship, and that if we are to communicate, if we are to pass on this legacy of faith to the generations coming behind us, that we need to communicate in a way that gives relationship value. It's all about relationship. And you know, God demands obedience. He does. It's important for us to obey, but he demands obedience because he loves us. And he wants what's best for us, and he wants a relationship with us. And so if we're going to communicate that, if we're going to pass that on, in fact, if we're going to communicate the good news of the gospel to anybody, we got to communicate in a way that gives relationship value. We learned in week number 3 that it's our example that is so crucial as well. That we can't pass along anything to anyone if it's not in us first. And so we learn to put ourselves first when it comes to spiritual growth. Put ourselves first when it comes to spiritual growth. And then last week we talked about the intentional effort that we all have to make if we're going to pass on this legacy of faith to the generations coming behind us. And so we learned a legacy principle number... What's happening here? What is happening with the slides? These are the slides from last week. So we'll move on here. So legacy principle Number four, we talked about the intentional effort that we need to make, that we have to make faith conversations a significant part and a natural part of everyday life. And then put our faith into action. We need to help the younger generations and our kids see that it's not just a Sunday thing. It's an everyday thing. It's an everyday kind of faith. And so today we're going to look at legacy principle number five, and we're gonna see how important it is that we all take responsibility for this. Every single one of us, that we all take responsibility. So as we look at responsibility, I want to look back at the very beginning of the Shema, Deuteronomy chapter 6, and we just read it. We talked about it in week number one, and I just want to focus on the first three words. Let's revisit the first three words. Hear, O Israel. Hear, O Israel. Not hear, O parents, or hear, O community leaders, or hear, O pastors, or hear, O youth pastors, or hear, O children's workers, but hear, O Israel. And when we actually go back a little bit in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 1, and we look at the very first part of Moses' speech, his sermon to the people of Israel, we read this: Moses summoned all of Israel and said these things. He summoned all of Israel. You see, it was the responsibility of the entire nation of Israel to pass on this legacy of faith for the spiritual development of the children coming behind. And for us, and we've been saying this, I've been saying this every single week in the series, that's for us, it's the church's responsibility to pass on this legacy of faith to the generations coming behind us. It's not just the responsibility of pastors or youth pastors or children's leaders or workers. It's every single one of us who calls ourselves followers of Christ. It's our responsibility to pass on, to leave this legacy of faith to the generations coming behind us. And so parents, I want to talk to you for a second. Parents, you can't do it alone. And I think you know that. We know that, don't we? If you're currently a parent, you know, of young kids and kids still in your home, or if you've had kids in your home, you know that it's so difficult and it's challenging and you can't do it on your own. And there are so many times that I know I feel like a failure so many times, and I realize that I can't do it on my own. You can't do it on your own. Now we need one another. And so this is so important, parents. This is so important that you pursue strategic relationships for your kids. Pursue strategic relationships for your kids. And don't wait until they're older. Don't wait until they're older, because this is kind of a newsflash. Maybe it's probably not a newsflash. You probably realize this, that when they get a little bit older, they're not going to want to listen to what you have to say. I mean, at some point, you know, so when your kids are younger, you're kind of like their hero, and they want to be like you, and they want to do everything that you do, and they listen, and they hang on your every word. And then at some point in time, probably around the teenage years, they don't believe you anymore. They don't necessarily want to listen to what you have to say anymore. And so, you know, for instance, and this is kind of a silly example, my son Max, he's never eaten peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. I don't know why, because peanut butter and jelly sandwiches are great. We try to tell him that. We'll just want to make a simple lunch, you know, or pack a lunch to take to the beach or whatever. Peanut butter and jelly is just simple. It's simple to make, it's quick, it's easy, and they're good. And we tell him that. How about a peanut butter and jelly? No, I don't want them. They're gross. I hate them. And he would not eat peanut butter and jelly sandwiches until the age of 16. Well, he's almost 16. Age of 15, he'll be 16 in a few days. So just a few days ago, he comes home and he says, I just had a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, and they're so good. Well, How did you eat a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? Well, my girlfriend's mom made it for me. Now he loves peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. And that's just a simple, silly example. But at some point in time, your kids aren't going to want to listen to you. They're not going to want to hear what you have to say. And it's at that point when that happens that you're going to want other voices speaking into their lives, other voices of committed followers of Jesus, adults and peers of their same age who know and love the Lord. And if your kids haven't been committed to a community of faith up until that point, then you may have missed out on those strategic relationships, the relationships that come naturally sometimes as being a part of a church family. There is going to be a voice. In fact, there's going to be lots of voices, many someones speaking into the lives of your children. And who do you want speaking into their lives? What voices do you want them to listen to? You can begin, when they're young, strategically placing people in their lives. People who have the same worldview as you. People who have the same values as you. People who are going to say the same things that you say. Your kids may not listen to you, but they'll end up listening to them. People that they love and respect. When my son Max, and I'm telling another story about Max, but he's in the other room watching right now, so hi Max. Sorry I talk about you a lot. But when he became a teenager, my wife planned something special for him, and some of you have done the same thing for your kids, and it's nothing new. Christy actually read about this and got this idea from another person, but she decided to plan something special as he was coming into his teenage years. And so we chose 6 adult men from the church to speak into his life, and they were to take him out and do something special for him, take him on a trip or a day trip or just for a few hours or whatever, and spend some time with them and speak into his life as a teenager. Teach him something, give him something special to think about as he's heading into his teenage years. And then Max kept a journal, and he wrote down everything that he did with each person and what he learned, and he'll have that for a long time. And it was just another way for us to pursue strategic relationships for our kids. People that will speak into their lives and say the same things that we want to say to them. And we've always been blessed to be a part of great churches and great youth groups, and our kids have built those relationships with people. And so we've really pursued those strategic relationships for our kids. Here at Living Grace, we have a special guy named Jacob Massey. You guys know, most of you know Jacob. And if you don't know him, if you're just watching online or if you're here visiting, he's the guy that was playing the drums, and he's our youth pastor here at Living Grace, and he's such an incredible guy. He wants to help you pursue strategic relationships for your middle schoolers and for your high schoolers. And Peggy Shane has been working with our children, and Brandy Johnson, who's actually running the camera in the back of the room, they've been working with our children. And they want to help you pursue strategic relationships for your children. That is our goal here at Living Grace. We want to reach families of kids and students so we can help parents pursue strategic relationships for their kids. Parents can't do it on their own. And the church, we can't do it on our own either. You know, some parents think that all they have to do is bring their kids to church. But, you know, that's just basically 1 hour a week. And while that's important, you know, just think of all the hours that the parents have at home during the week to speak into the lives of their kids. They spend countless more hours with their kids than leaders at church, than volunteers at church. Especially now during this virus, you have lots of time with your kids. Lots of time to make an impact in their lives. And so legacy principle number 5 is this. We need to work together as a community of faith to make a difference in the lives of our kids. We need to work together. We need one another. And so let's just kind of think about specific ways that we can apply this. No matter who you are, no matter what stage of life you're in, maybe you're a parent, maybe you're not a parent, maybe your kids have left home, maybe you still have younger kids in the home. Let's all kind of think about this together. Let's focus on parents, first of all. You are the primary spiritual leaders in your kids' lives. You are. You're the primary spiritual leaders in your kids' lives. Don't leave it up to the church. You are the primary spiritual leaders in your kids' lives. And so as a church, we want to come alongside you and we want to encourage you in that effort. Keep up the good work. You're making a difference. You're making a difference for all of eternity. And sometimes in the moment, it feels so hard and it feels so difficult and you feel like you can't go on and you can't do it. But keep on because you're making a difference for all of eternity. You're leaving a legacy of faith and that's so important. But some of you as parents with kids at home still need to do more. You need to do more. I mean, can you imagine the impact it would make in the life of a child if a dad started praying with his child at night before bed, when he's never done it before? Maybe this is your time to start just a simple prayer with your kids before they go to bed. Just imagine the impact that could make. Or a mom who has never read the scripture, maybe just before bed, a mom could open up the words of the scripture and just read a few verses to their kids. Just think the impact that could make. Or even a grandparent having faith conversations with your kids on a regular basis. Look how great God is. Look at how great God has done, all the things God has done. That could make an incredible impact in the lives of our kids and our grandkids. And if you're a parent and you have kids at home and you're not sure where to start, you know, we are here to help as a church and we can provide resources for you. So we mentioned the connection card earlier. Katie mentioned the connection card. This is an opportunity. If you say, I'm not sure where to start, I want to do something, but I don't know how, you can just indicate that on your connection card. That I want help with resources and passing on this legacy to my kids. And we'll get a hold of you and we'll help you take the next step in doing this. And we'll provide some resources to help you do this. Now, as a church, what do we need to do? Whether we have kids or not, we need to partner with parents. And so some of you can volunteer in our ministries. Some of you can be children's workers. Some of you can be youth workers. Not because we need you, not because we need to babysit the kids and chaperone the kids, not because we need to get the kids out of here so they're not noisy during the service. No, it's far bigger than that. We want to partner with parents in leaving a legacy of faith that will last for all of eternity. That's so important. And so we need you. We need you to be a volunteer and to take the responsibility and play this vital role in the lives of our kids and our youth. And so here's the thing about all that. We've got this new building next door. We've got this youth and children's center that's we haven't been able to really use yet because of you know, COVID-19. And you know, we're still unsure what's going to happen in the next few weeks and months. And so we're not really sure what the timing is, when we can get back in there and start using that for ministry, for kids, and for youth. But hopefully in the near future, we will be able to do that. And so, if you want to be a part of that, we're gonna need people to hold babies in the nursery and love on them. We're gonna need people to work with preschoolers, elementary age kids. We're gonna need people to work with middle schoolers and high school students. And if you are interested in volunteering in that way, jot that down on your connection card. And Katie mentioned that here in the seats, there are connection cards. You can fill those out and put them in the basket on the way out. Online, there's a link to the connection card just at the top of the page if you're watching from our website. That's a way that you can take responsibility. Now, some of you can't do that, and that's understandable. And let's be honest, some of you shouldn't do that. Maybe Maybe you just don't have the patience for that, and that is understandable, and that is okay. But as we talked about in week number two, you can still be an example. You can still model a living, breathing, active relationship with Christ for the next generation to see and to watch and to follow. You can do that. And another way that you can take responsibility is to adopt a child or student. And when I say that, I mean to support them during this coming school year. And this is something new that we're going to try here at Living Grace. If you're a student, you know that this past school year, especially the end of the school year, was kind of different and it was kind of difficult. This next school year, maybe as well. It's going to be very different and it may be very difficult. And so if you want to adopt a elementary age child, middle school, high school, or a college student for the school year, indicate that on your connection card, and we will hook you up with a student and with their parents. And here's what you can do to support them. You can send them notes of encouragement, letters of encouragement. You can send them care packages if they're away to college. You can even send them a text or an email or send them a message on Facebook. You can pray regularly for them and support them in that way. Send them a card on their birthday. I'm sure you can be creative and find other ways that you can support them. If you are interested in doing that, adopting a elementary age child, middle school, high school, or college student for this school year, indicate that on your connection card and send that in. These are ways that we can work together. We can partner with parents, and parents can rely on us as well, and we can work together for the responsibility of leaving a legacy of faith to the generations coming behind us. So in conclusion, not only for today's message, as we talked about responsibility, but in concluding the entire series, I want to go to Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 29. And here in this verse, we see God's heart for the nation of Israel. Oh, that their hearts would be inclined to fear me and keep all my commands always, so that it might go well with them and their children forever. And we know, and you may know this, that it didn't go well for them. That the Israelites failed to pass on this legacy of faith to the generations coming behind. They forgot God, and their children forgot all about God. And many, even nowadays, say that it's not going well for us as well. Studies show, statistics show, that there's a pretty grim reality in the church today. That many of the next generation are leaving the church when they head off to college. And some of the statistics say that it's as much as 88%. 88% of kids who grow up in the church and are active in the church, when they head off to to college, they kind of leave the faith of their parents and their grandparents behind. They leave the church behind. Now, I'm hoping that that's improving a little bit. And maybe you believe the 88%, maybe you don't. And that percentage, you know, I don't even want to get hung up on the percentage, but all I have to do is look around, and I've been in many churches, and I've seen that there's some truth in this. There's been a mass exodus of the younger generation in our churches. A bunch of the next generation is abandoning the church and the faith of their parents and their grandparents. They're abandoning truth, and they're abandoning a relationship with their Creator. But I firmly believe that there's hope. And I believe that the verdict is still out. And I believe that there are many of you who are making a huge difference in the lives of kids and in the lives of the generations coming behind. inside the walls of the church, outside these walls, you're making an impact, you're making a difference. And I believe that if we have a solid foundation, that we start there with this solid foundation, that the Lord our God is one and he is our one and only, and we focus our priorities. If it's true that he really is our one and only, and we focus our priorities on what matters most. And if we communicate this relationship and we give relationship value, that it's not just a bunch of lists of do's and don'ts and a bunch of rules. It's that along with relationship. And when we show an example worth following, and we put ourselves first when it comes to spiritual growth, and when we make some intentional effort, and it's going to take intentional effort, when we make faith conversations a significant part and a natural part of our everyday lives and put faith into action and help the generations coming behind see that it's not just a Sunday thing, it's not just an hour on Sunday mornings where we sit in these seats, but it's an everyday thing that matters, significant to every area of our lives. And when we work together and we take the responsibility together as parents, as grandparents, as aunts and uncles, and as the church, and we work together as a community of faith to make a difference, I believe that we will pass on this legacy of faith, a legacy that's eternal and lasting and real to the generations coming behind and to our kids. And I think that's so exciting. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this time to look into your word, the things that we have been learning over the past few weeks about legacy, and it's been very challenging. It's very challenging to me, and it's very easy to look back and see all the times I've failed. I pray that we will all be encouraged by this, and that from here on out, we will be intentional. We will put these things into action and into practice in our lives so that we can make a difference in the generations coming behind us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. As we wrap up this series, I just want to talk a little bit about what's coming next week, because this is really important as well, and I'm really excited about this, and I think as we look around and we see everything that's happening in our world and in our country right now, it's been kind of crazy, hasn't it? There's been so much happening in the year 2020. And you know what? It's really hard sometimes to know what to believe. We've got so many conflicting opinions, so much advice out there. We should believe this, we should believe that, we should do this, we should do that. And sometimes it's so hard for us to believe, but you know what? There's never a question how we should respond. There's never a question how we should respond. As followers of Christ, as the church, it is very, very clear how we should respond. Jesus has spoken about it over and over again, and he's modeled it for us. And so we're going to spend the next few weeks talking about how we can respond in the midst of all this. We've talked about that a little bit in the past, but it's so important that we get this right, because of everything that's going on, this is such an opportunity for us. This is an incredible opportunity for us to be salt and to be light and to be what the church should be, and to respond in the way that Jesus has called us to respond. It's an opportunity. So I just want to talk this up, because I'm excited about this series, and I think you should be excited about it too. And I think you should talk it up, and you should share it with others so that they can join us as well, whether it be online or here in person. We want to be a church that responds in the right way, that responds the way Jesus responds. And so I just want to make that plug for next week. So be back next week. for respond. And the other thing that I want to mention as well, we have to find a way to grow together. We have to find a way to process these things that we're learning, especially as we head into this next series. And so you probably received an email, if you're a part of our church, that we're going to be starting community groups just 3 weeks long. Just 3 week long community groups starting next week. And we're going to process the things that we're learning in this next series. And so on Sunday after church, we're going to have one the next three Sundays from 12 to 1. And so we're going to meet right outside in the yard behind the house. Bring your lawn chairs. You'll have time after church to go grab some lunch and to come back. And then we're gonna join together outside. If you're watching online and you're still not comfortable coming back to the building, maybe you'll be comfortable to watch online and then jump in your car and join us here in the yard for our group time after the service, 3 weeks in a row. And then on Tuesday nights, starting next week, we're going to do the same. We've been having takeout Tuesday on Tuesday nights. We've got one more week of that, and then the following week we'll begin this as well. The same thing. We're going to meet in the yard, bring your lawn chairs, bring your dinner, and we're going to eat together, and we're going to discuss these things that we're learning in the series, in the next series, and we're going to spend some time praying together. So I encourage you to be a part of one of these groups, Sunday after church, Tuesday night, especially if you've never done it before. And if you have questions, jot that down on your connection card and I'll get in touch with you and we'll talk about it. But give it a try. It's just 3 weeks long and we want to learn and grow together. We want to take our next step in following Jesus together. So be here next week and join us in one of these three-week community groups. We're going to conclude our service together by lifting up our praise and song. So stand with us and let us sing together and worship the Lord.
The sun to the ending of the Once again, thank you for being here this morning, here in the room, next door in the overflow room, and everyone online. We are so grateful that you've joined us, and we ask that you join us next week as we jump into a new series. Have a great week.